Thank you. First, I want to welcome all of you to this space today. It is a sad occasion in a lot of ways. The way it was expressed for me was I didn't want to go in that sacristy and put on these vestments. I want to just visit with all my friends out here. And the reason I didn't want to put on those vestments was that mean the service starts. And yet, I know that the church has gifts for people like us who have feelings like what we have right now. And those gifts are in place. And you will experience them during the service. So I welcome you here and hope that this will be exactly what you need today. I am resurrection, and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. We'll certainly talk about that. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awaking, he will raise me up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him, who is my friend and not a stranger. For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord. And if we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. God is with us. God's love unites us. God's purpose steadies us. God's Spirit comforts us. We have come together to remember before God the life of Peter, to commend him to God's keeping, and to comfort those who mourn with our sympathy and with our love. In the hope we share through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Peter. We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading from Ecclesiastes. There is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to uproot. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to tear down, and a time to build. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Second reading is from Romans. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attracts the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Peter Makuck, he was a good man. Kind, compassionate, empathetic, generous, supportive, loving husband and father. And Peter was good in another sense, accomplished. Fulbright scholar, nationally known prize-winning poet and creative writer, distinguished professor at East Carolina University, tennis player, skier, and not the least, prolific joke teller. I was amazed how he could remember them all in English and in French. What a boundless sense of humor. And yet with all his accomplishments, he was so humble. He never mentioned any of these accomplishments. It was years after meeting Peter when at an ECU convocation that Phyllis invited my wife and I to attend that he was awarded to be the third distinguished professor in the history of East Carolina University. When he gave his acceptance speech, I remember it. He said, "I've been lucky." Well, I was lucky to have met Peter about 30 years ago at a cookout in Greenville. We started talking and we realized we had much in common. We're both from Connecticut, Slavic heritage, parochial school, Skull College, all that stuff. But what was the instantaneous glue? Well, Peter and Phyllis had a boat here. I had a house here. We both liked to fish. And that began a great friendship, the best friendship. And he was the one who made it happen. When Phyllis asked me to say a few words today, I thought about why Peter was so special. He was special because he loved people and was so interested in everyone. And he made an effort to get to know them very well. Not really in what the person did, but what that person was interested in and what they were like and their story. But it was he who was so interesting to be with. With his knowledge of art, literature, music, history, cinema, philosophy, theology, and of course, fishing and trapping, and especially telling of his jokes and stories about his life experiences, which were not only interesting, but so many times hilarious. I remember being in line in a ski lift with him, or just being at a movie waiting in line, and I would turn away. And before you know it, Peter was talking to somebody, a perfect stranger. And so I listened. And he did that in such a friendly and humorous, attractive way. And if you were fortunate to have Peter as a friend, your experience was probably the same. And you instantly liked him. And with his friends, he could be very funny, serious, philosophical, or just listen. And because he had no problem in revealing himself to you, and the fact that he was warm, honest, and non-critical, you felt comfortable in sharing your thoughts with him. And that was the source of a lasting and deep friendships. Peter had that special talent. I guess I would call it the art of connection. He could connect with people. And Peter would nourish those friendships by keeping contact with his friends. Call them, email them, send them a letter, visit them, or invite them to their house. He kept up with a range of friends from boyhood until he physically could not. I read over 100 of responses from those friends mentioning him as compassionate, generous, caring, with a great sense of humor, and how he used to send them a joke through email or letter just to get them to laugh, and how they enjoyed his vivid poems. Yes, Peter loved people, and as a result, people loved him back. And why so many people called him a close friend and a special person. When Peter and Phyllis were living in Pine Hill Shores, Peter was still teaching at ECU. So he stayed with us in Greenville from Tuesdays to Thursdays for 10 years. He became part of our family. He always pitched in, even babysitting for a baby. Cheryl and I had 3 boys, and we all enjoyed his company for years. And to this day, they still talk about him telling jokes at the dinner table. But he felt he was imposing. And he would say, "I don't even think my family would even put up with me to take me in." But we all look forward to his arrivals on Tuesday. He loved his students and teaching. When he came home in the evening, we'd often open a bottle of wine and wind down. And then he would always talk about his students, their writing, their interests, their progress and challenges, his concerns for them. And his teaching was not limited to the classroom. He took them out for beers, into coffee poetry readings, and helped them usually as an unofficial counselor and mentor. I remember one student was living in his car. I remember his name, Jeff. And Peter found him odd jobs so he could afford to stay in school. And now Jeff's a teacher. Even after students graduated, he kept in touch with them for years. He was interested in their careers, their families, and help them throughout their lives. He touched so many people, so many students. I read so many comments from his former students who admired him. "Best professor I ever had. His class was a turning point in my life. Beloved professor." Not many professors like Peter. And Peter loved his whole family, especially Phyllis and Keith, of course. He always looked forward to going to Connecticut in the summer for his family reunions and to look up his old college and high school friends, and going to Arizona to spend Christmas holidays every year with Phyllis's family, the Zarellas at Joe and Diana's, and anxious to see Paul and Martha and all the nephews and nieces. And Keith, he loved telling me about your antics as a kid in France, your times in the family farm, and your school playground at ECU Computer Lab, and how industrious and reliable you were, cooking at the Norman College and then working at UNC. Your father joked, he often said, that as far as your work ethic, he would say, well, he took after my father, not after me. Well, I know it's been difficult for you in the last few months, Keith, traveling from Chapel Hill, take care of your dad, but I know how much you want to spend this time with you. He was always proud of you. And Phyllis, he told me he was lucky to marry you. You and Peter were an inseparable couple, and anyone who knew them just couldn't miss that. We saw that you loved being together, whether fishing, playing tennis, discussing your work, entertaining, or just watching a movie. Peter and Phyllis were the closest friends and companions, and one of his students expressed this better than I could. They had the kind of marriage that I thought couldn't possibly exist, but it did. It not only stood the test of time, it shone more brightly each passing year. During their separate illnesses, I saw them taking care of each other, and recently Phyllis never left his side. And knowing his limited time, Peter told me he had one fear or worry about death, that Phyllis would be left behind. We are sad that we lost Peter. We will miss him. But we are not separated from him at all. Indelible memories, which no one can take from us, keep us eternally united. I have the memories, especially those fishing expeditions offshore on the Makuck, catching wahoo, mahi, and tuna. And when I want to, I need him around. I'll just read his poems and he'll be there. And maybe I can remember some of his jokes that keep me laughing and see his smile. Peter grew up in New London, where Long Island Sound begins to open into the Atlantic Ocean. And Peter would have to pardon me because I know how much he disliked cliches, but he had salt water in his veins. And he lived his dream here in Pine Shores, where he wrote much of his poetry, inspired by this island, until his medical condition required him to move to Wilmington. But here was always his home. And here, Peter and Phyllis found St. Francis by the Sea. They both felt that this kind, beautiful church community, with Reverend Everett as pastor, was their spiritual home. And that Christianity here was so welcoming and meaningful, so much so that he was inspired by the beauty of this island and church and faith to compose the preface to the Eucharist. Peter was bonded to this church and to this community, and he wished his final religious service and interment be at this earthly home. So we are here and nowhere else today, not just to celebrate his life. We're here as Christians to celebrate Peter's faith and his hope of the resurrection and life everlasting in his heavenly home, which should comfort us all. It's truly fitting that Peter, a man who lived the prayer of St. Francis, rest here. I'll end with this. Whoops. When the low sun spreads its orange oil on Bog Sound, and when the island ripens into darkness, you gift us with bright constellations and infuse us with awe at the mystery of your infinite spaces and the heaven that awaits us. From the preface, Peter Makuck.
Ed, that was excellent. Thank you. That helped me a lot. Please stand. The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered on the cross, was crucified, and died. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The prayers of the people. For our brother Peter, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you console Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Peter and dry the tears of those who weep.
Hear us, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. You raise the dead to life. Give to our brother eternal life. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our brother to the joys of heaven. Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints. He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrow at the death of our brother Peter. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope.
Father of all, we pray to you for Peter, and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. May his soul and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you. Thank you. one day, we were sitting in that little chapel right there, having a Celtic Eucharist. We were using a liturgy from Scotland. And Peter had just died. And I was extremely sad and told him so. And so, of course, the conversation that day was about Peter and our response to his life in this church. And I was totally amazed at what happened. And it helped me as much as anything has during this whole season. About half of the people in there had never met Peter. You know, they came in the last 5 years or so. And the others of us knew him really, really well. But it was one of the people who didn't know him, a new person, but who had heard these liturgies that we use all the time, which have Peter's work in them. And she said, well, Peter can never die because too many of us carry him in our hearts. And then the group started talking about what they meant by that. That you can't carry, once you meet Peter, you can't carry in your heart a sunset. It has to be the low sun spreading its orange oil on Bogue Sound. And once you really get that inside, you can't let it go. It's too beautiful. And then I would say, well, the night then comes. And he would say something about the island ripening into darkness. And that image just stays with you forever. And a pelican, one person said, every time I see a pelican gliding through the air, I think of Peter and his talking about that, which I'll read in a moment. But all of these images in this preface to the Eucharist are images that have been read in this church a billion times. Enough that they are part of us, part of our lives, part of our way of seeing. And you know, Peter's work is always prefaced and shot through and through by his love and gratitude for God. And so, after a few weeks of this in that room right there, Phyllis actually showed up for a Wednesday Eucharist. I'm always asking people to share in the readings. And I said, who would like to read Peter's preface? And she said, I would. And she did. And she told some things about that preface that I did not know. I knew when I asked him to do it, I asked him to write a preface for the Eucharist. It was supposed, I thought it would be 2 to 3 sentences long. That's what I was expecting. But I had to ask Peter Makuck to write a prayer. And he wasn't so sure he could pull that off. And he told Phyllis, I don't think I can do it. But he went upstairs to the third story of their house in Pine Knoll Shores, where he could see to the ocean and the sound and the live oaks and the birds. And he wrote this prayer. in just a matter of minutes, never edited it, brought it down, gave it to Phyllis. Which says to me, not only was he a poet, he was also a conduit for the Holy Spirit. That's an amazing thing to happen this beautiful and to change this many lives and ways of seeing this beautiful environment that we are fortunate to be part of. So I'm glad that we have put this preface in here so that you could hear what we in this church have heard so many times that it's part of us. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, Holy Creator, that you allow us to live surrounded by evidence of your divinity on this island where we find what St. Francis loved, the endless improvisation of mockingbirds and sculpted bodies of live oaks, the great blue heron in stilted slow motion through jade shallows, a kingfisher in its hover and dive, a sandpiper's blurred scurry, pelicans in their elegant ground effect glides. Too often we turn our backs, dear God, on you and exile ourselves in favor of phantoms that falsely flatter. But you do not forget us. And in your goodness and mercy, readily welcome us back to the grace notes of your kingdom, that we might be restored and learn once again who we really are. As Jesus was, we are called to islands of solitude, to vast stores of unused quiet to be with you, to immensities of oceanic blue that enlarge our souls and remind us of eternity and of what passes, but with promise, of the low sun spreads its orange oil on Bogue Sound. And when the island ripens into darkness, you gift us with bright constellations and infuse us with awe at the mystery of your infinite spaces and the heavens that await us. Right. And so we come together today under a sun-shafted canopy of maritime forest to receive your word and join with saints and angels in a chorus of praise and thanks that rings through eternity lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. The night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that your great love, you have fed us with the spiritual food and drink, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and fill you with peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. The commendation. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints.
Where sorrow and anger are no more, in my society, a life everlasting.
Let us pray. Gracious God, nothing in death or life, in the world as it is, or the world as it shall be, nothing in all creation can separate us from your love. We commend Peter into your loving care. Enfold him in the arms of your mercy. Bless his dying and his rising again in you. Bless those whose hearts are filled with sadness, that they too may know the hope of the resurrection. For the sake of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Go forth, Peter, on your journey from this world. In the love of God the Father, who created you, and the mercy of Jesus the Redeemer, who suffered for you, and the power of the Holy Spirit, who keeps you in eternal life, may you dwell this day in peace and rest in the presence of God.
Amen.
God of all consolation, grant to those who sorrow the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have the strength to meet the days ahead with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing without hope, but trusting in your goodness, who is the resurrection and the life, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, to defend you, within you, to keep you, before you, to lead you, beside you, to guard you, and above you, to bless you. The Lord bless and keep you. The Lord make his countenance shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his head on you and give you peace. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
There you go.